All right, let's get started. This is going to be a quick little welcome and introduction to folks that are attending OSPOCon as part of Open Source Summit. So for those of you who don't know me, my name is Chris Anizek. I have the fun job of helping run the Cloud Native Computing Foundation at the Linux Foundation, but also am involved in a lot of other efforts, things like To-Do Group, which kind of helps organize OSPOCon along with kind of a variety of other things at the Linux Foundation, from starting foundations and all that good stuff. What's interesting about this event is, traditionally at Open Source Summit, we've always had this like open source programs track or like open source type of track, and it was last year that we finally decided, why don't we actually kind of make this a more formal, larger part of the program. And so I kind of want to thank a lot of folks that were involved in a lot of those discussions that kind of push us, like, some of us, work at OSPOs and so on. Why don't we actually have, a formal event, around kind of our career and craft. So, thank you for all those folks that supported us in putting this together. It's been kind of a journey. Anytime you do a first event of its own of its own type. Also, as you saw in Jim's keynote, we're definitely taking health and safety serious at this event. For many of us, it's our first conference in way too long, and we're kind of all adapting to this new way of doing things and then transitioning back to back to business. So, to kind of, formally kick this off before handing it off to, our wonderful speakers, Nithya's up next, I just kind of want to lay, what's actually going on and why are OSPOs becoming more critical to many different parts of the industry. So as many of you folks are aware, almost every company out there is, making a digital transformation. They're either deciding, hey, we need to replatform and become more of a software company. We need to bring engineering in-house. I just saw this recent example from Porsche, which is an automotive company. I'm sure many of you know them, where they recently started an open source office. And basically for them, they're basically like, it is almost existential for us to essentially embrace software as part of our organization. If we essentially don't, do this, we may be in trouble and we may not be able to adapt due to all the competition that's going on. And to be honest, cars historically have always shipped a ton of, software. It's just that what's happened is, there's more and more things that are, being part of your car. You have a whole experience. You have, auto navigation and so on. So software is a critical piece of that. And you could see Nick Peters from Porsche basically, said that, the whole benefits here of, Porsche embracing an OSPO and becoming more open source forward is, they're getting high level software maturity, reduced cost, potentially faster development cycles, and shorter time to market. A lot of us who have worked, in the tech industry, whether it's, been at traditional companies, Amazon, Microsoft, Google, we've all seen these benefits for many years, and that's kind of why these organizations adopted OSPOs. It's just we're seeing this kind of next wave of companies essentially adopting, open source program offices as a way to kind of move themselves forward. So, I don't have to explain this to you. Open source is truly, everywhere. It's completely phenomenal to kind of see things, as you kind of come across them. My wife and I are kind of building our first house, and just the amount of things that you come across that it's like, why do toilets have, internet access, and why do fridges, everything's like connected, there's software everywhere. And a lot of these companies and organizations that build these, things are, they have to become software companies themselves. So it's just truly amazing to kind of see how things have evolved, with this over time. I think OSPOs are playing a critical, role here as this kind of center within a company organization to kind of truly push forward best practices and so on. And what's interesting is, doing a little bit of history and research of kind of like, where have OSPOs come from, which one's like the first OSPO. I think, if you kind of look back, the early corporate OSPOs, things that you saw at, Sun, Intel, IBM, I think kind of truly laid the foundation of where things are today. And those generally focus on optimizing how we could consume software that was open source, how we kind of produce and release open source software while pleasing our lawyers at the time. And I really call that kind of like OSPO 1.0 kind of basic, foundations that were basically tech tech-forward companies, your Suns, Intels, IBMs, Microsofts, Googles, they all kind of went and adopted OSPOs you know, over time. What we've kind of seen in the last 5 years is, you know, a next set of companies that are kind of embracing their digital transformation journeys. Your folks like, you know, Porsche, your automotive companies. You're seeing gaming companies now adopt more open source practices. But what's also kind of a new trend is there's been a lot of great folks pushing forwards to having open source be critical in academic environments. So there's universities out there like Johns Hopkins, RIT, that actually have formal kind of open source program centers there. There's a big push in government now, you know, not only from like a policy perspective, but, you know, trying to evolve these practices of, you know, how governments procure, you know, software, open source software that, you know, is a little bit different how they've done things with commercial software. So you're seeing a big push in the EU where recent regulation and, you know, documentation has pushed that, like, there's going to be things such as government OSPOs across EU in the future. So we're kind of seeing this wonderful evolution of, you know, open source being just a focal point in not only just corporations and traditional tech companies, but a new set of companies and also, you know, governments and academia. So, you know, To-Do Group, where, you know, where did it come from and so on. So I think originally, there was a small group of us in the Bay Area, you know, at the time that essentially were running open source programs. I think it was a Twitter, Facebook, and Google initially, and we were kind of just, you know, sharing practices. Had a private mailing list of like, hey, what happens if you, you know, ship GPL software accidentally here? Like, this something, you know, how do you do this? And so eventually, you know, this small network started, you know, to grow while other, you know, companies approached us, and we formally, you know, started the To-Do Group in 2012 to kind of bring together a set of companies to share practices, produce information, because, you know, the fact of like people individually reaching out to you privately over, you know, email just doesn't scale, right? And, you know, hey, we run open source at companies, maybe we should open source some material to help help people out. So, you know, it was founded in 2012. It's kind of grown to encompass a lot of the early, I would say, kind of progenitors and kind of leaders of the OSPO movement. We have 60 plus companies and organizations from, you know, corporations, universities that are starting to evolve to kind of help grow this essentially network of OSPOs and information. If you look at the organization, it produces kind of great content. We've always had our guides that a lot of people have referenced. We have an OSPO 101 course. We kind of have this new program we've kind of started called OSPology, which is all about, you know, sharing, you know, how people kind of do OSPOs in a more public fashion than we traditionally have, you know, within the organization. Kind of another big thing we do is surveys. I think for the last 4 years, we've been kind of this, let's go survey the industry of like, you know, how are you doing OSPO, you know, management within your organization and so on. And so today we're happy to kind of announce our, I think, fourth edition of the OSPO survey results, which, you know, if you kind of look and dive into this report is, you know, obviously the tech, you know, traditional tech industry is leading the forefront of open source programs and so on, but what we're actually seeing is a lot more kind of OSPOs coming from non-traditional areas like academia, government, and kind of, you know, let's call it laggards in kind of the, you know, the tech industry. So overall, kind of think great information that you could go look on, you know, GitHub. It's all available for you to kind of review, look at, and kind of learn from. And, you know, I hope things like this truly help us, you know, take open source program management OSPOs as like a serious career path for many folks, because to me it's a great kind of community. And for those that have known me, I kind of hearken this to what happened in like how CISOs kind of came to be. If you kind of know the story, I think it was, you know, Citibank in the mid 90s where they just got hacked and it was bad. They lost like tens of millions of dollars and are like, all right, we got to do something, right? Hence, they hired their first CISO, and CISOs have kind of become, you know, a thing in the industry. And you're seeing the same thing, I think, happen to OSPOs, where, you know, sometimes companies were forced to hire like a compliance officer or someone to take their own open source. But a lot of companies now are realizing this is just so critical for us, given how open source is everywhere. So, you know, I you know, kind of want to stop, you know, with the welcome and intro. It's just so happy to kind of see so many faces in this room. I want to thank the program committee that was involved in putting this together. We have some, you know, great folks: Greg, Claire, Stephen, Anna, Craig, Dwayne, Justin, John, Ashley, and Henry. And I see some of you in the audience here, which is great. And thank you for the volunteer time in putting this wonderful program together. And I look forward to talking to many of you and seeing how we can kind of continue to improve, you know, OSPOCon and so on. We're doing an event in a couple is it next week? I don't even know anymore. I think it's next week in Europe. So we have the first OssipoCon in Europe, and look forward to seeing some of you hopefully there for that one. But other than that, thank you. I hope all of you take the time to network, learn from each other. If you're kind of need help with any OSPA related, let me know. There's a lot of great folks in this room that lead open source at a variety of companies, from Microsoft. We're going to hear from Nithya next on Comcast. And you know, there's a lot of great stuff online. So thank you for being here, and excited to see all your smiling faces behind the mask. So thanks all, and Nithya, whenever you want to get up. So thanks all. It's good to see you.